I want to say thank you to my parents, who played such an integral role in my development into the Catholic young man I've grown to be. And if I do say so myself, I think they've done a pretty good job. I extend my deepest gratitude to them, to my grandparents who never fail to spoil me and make sure I know that I am loved always, and to my siblings, especially my sister Genevieve here tonight, who have taught me one of the most important lessons of all, patience. Thank you also to the Most Reverend Bishop Spaulding for leading us in the celebration of the Mass tonight, and for your leadership as Shepherd of the Diocese of Nashville, a job that we know is no small task. Thank you also to all members of the diocese here tonight. Thank you to the students of JP2, most especially my senior peers, for accepting me into this wonderful, tight-knit, and unbreakable community, and embracing me as one of your own. And last but certainly not least, thank you to the esteemed faculty and staff of Pope John Paul II Preparatory School for your tireless commitment to those in your care, especially over the trying times in the past few years, and for consistently being not only our mentors, but also our friends. Thank you for considering me to receive this Kmiec Award. It brings me great joy and pleasure that God has put me in a position to have earned the trust and respect of both my peers and my mentors. That is everything I could have asked for entering into high school and going forward with my life. That is the only reward I truly need. On the other hand, I think it ironic that as I was finishing up my last high school exams, celebrating that all the hard work had paid off and was finally done, Mr. Griffith pulls Kate and I into his office, closes the door, and tells us, "Congratulations, here's an award, now go write a speech." Of course, Mr. Griffith said that much more articulately and sympathetically, but I just thought it funny that our reward for being given an award is more work. Now, as far as I'm aware, there isn't really a specific structure of this speech that is expected to follow, but somehow Kate and I are going to hammer on some of the same points. But being the second semester, scratch that, post-second semester senior that I am, fully fallen victim to senioritis, I got a little lazy and ultimately decided to model the speech off of talks that I have already written over the course of high school. These include discussions on the topics of challenge, Christian love, and discipleship. So, lucky for you seniors who missed half of the discipleship talk, you get to hear me speak in full this time. And, assuming most of y'all aren't late coming again. I think it is safe to say the high school experience of this class of 2022 has become synonymous with the word challenge. We have earned our place in the history books, for better or for worse, after being forced into isolation, shut up in our houses with the people that we both love and can't stand the most. And yet, at JP2, we still continue to learn. We were asked to wear masks that placed a divide between us greater than just a piece of paper or cloth. And yet, behind those walls, at JP2, we still smiled in spite of it all. We have faced great loss within our school community, multiple times over, each time no easier than the last. We have mourned and grieved our losses, wishing that these people might have been allowed to continue on with us, even if just a little further. We have faced despair, trial, tribulation, overwhelming stress and anxiety, confusion, uncertainty, challenge. We have faced all of these things, and yet here we are today. At JP2, a Christian community is nurtured, and is it not the hallmark of Christianity to have hope in the face of overwhelming stress, and to be able to overcome insurmountable odds? Is it not by our Christianity that we celebrate and glorify the resurrection, even while standing at the very foot of the cross? Yes, we have faced loss and hardship and challenges of all shapes and sizes with all the odds stacked against us. Yet we persevere, as Kate said. We keep moving forward, we keep on running, and carry with us those who have passed every step of the way. As Philippians 4:13 reminds us, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. JP2 is a Christian community. Now to this idea of Christian love. It seems kind of obscure, right? This form of love is not a soft and fuzzy emotion or a warm and cuddly feeling, as love may commonly be perceived, but it's something more, as Bishop Spaulding alluded to today. No, we as Christians recognize As it is said at the entrance to our school's campus, God is love, and thus love is God. Christian love is allowing God to enter into and be present in our relationships with each other. It is by my parents' example that I have learned what it looks like to truly love. Allow me to recognize and witness that love exhibited at JP2 as well. This type of love is the selfless love of service with which my father, as a physician, tends to the needs of his patients tirelessly and without end, not counting the cost of what is expected of him, so long as he might improve just a single life. Christian love is the self-giving, sacrificial love of my mother, who offers herself totally and completely to my three younger siblings and I, committing her time, attention, and life to meeting our needs and making sure we are living the life God intends for us. I think this is pretty well summed up by the philosophy of my seven-year-old sister, who likes to remind herself, "Mommy loves us even when she's angry." Christian love is the love they have for each other. The complete gift of their whole selves, exclusively for each other and for those around them. In regards to JP2, it is by this love our school came to be, with teachers, coaches, and faculty who devote their lives to guiding, instructing, and inspiring us to pursue the best versions of ourselves. With students who, though we may not always be on time, may not always be mentally present in class, and still have a lot of growing and maturing to do. If nothing else, we have formed lasting, meaningful, loving relationships, and thus relationships in which God is ever present and acting. These relationships we have with our peers, our mentors, our family, are where God is at work in our lives, for that is where love is present. And where love resides, so too does God. JP2 is a loving family. And finally, a theme I hope most of the seniors will at least be somewhat familiar with at this point, discipleship. When writing all this, I was trying to figure out how all of these talks I had pulled from would tie together at the end. But man, did God make it easy for me, because I realized that what better to sum up the purpose of discipleship than that of being prepared to face challenges while so too being called to love. In Matthew's gospel, when Christ sends out his disciples to the world, he urges them to remember, without cost you have received, without cost you are to give. Christ has first set the example of what it means to give freely through his universal sacrifice, but also through the abundance of grace and mercy we receive. Even though we are not worthy of these gifts, he gives them freely in spite of the stain of our sin. But why? Because God acts not out of necessity, but out of love. Because God is love. So he asks his disciples, each of us, to follow this example and to in turn love freely, to give of ourselves and our love without cost. Next, facing challenges. The Christian life is not an easy road. There can be no Christianity without the suffering of the cross. Christ even promised that following him would be difficult. In a different account of him sending out his disciples that comes from Luke's gospel, he tells them, "Go on your way. Behold, I am sending you like lambs among wolves." In this broken world today, there are ample and endless opportunities for challenges to arise. And they are used to beat us down and discourage us so that we might not have the strength to continue on. But as I said before, it is in our nature to persevere, to hold out hope even when the whole world stands against us, because we have been exposed to what is good and true. Now, none of us are going to be able to live out a life of unconditional love or of facing endless challenges perfectly. But as you seniors might recall, most of you anyways, the word disciple comes from the Latin translation discipulus, which more closely means learner, pupil, student. The path to discipleship starts with growing, maturing, learning. And what better place to undergo this growth and receive this instruction than at a school? A school which roots itself in the values and principles of Christianity and creates within it a nurturing environment from which a culture and family of love arises. What better place than at, dare I say it, a Catholic school? JP2 is a Catholic school. Seniors, in this Christian community, this loving family, this Catholic school that is JP2, we have been formed into the versions of ourselves that are present here today. Surely our development as students, as disciples, is far from complete, But this foundation that has been laid and then these relationships formed could not have been done anywhere else. Cherish these last few moments among this family with which you have shared unforgettable memories and lifelong lessons. Time passes, but what you have experienced here lasts forever. So now, as we continue on to the next chapter of our lives, whatever it may be, face all challenges that come your way, equipped with hope, and cultivate a culture of Christian love in your words and actions by loving as God first loves, selflessly and unconditionally. Thank y'all for everything. It's been a pleasure. Stephen out. May God bless.